Hola, I'm Ellen McLean.
And I'm John Patrick Lowry.
And this is Universo Valve.
How did we meet each other? We met on a European tour of a Broadway show. Ellen was playing the lead on stage, and I was playing banjo and guitar in the pit orchestra. And Ellen was supposed to play guitar for herself. She was supposed to accompany herself on guitar in her part on stage, and I was supposed to give her guitar lessons. Well, I gave her one guitar lesson, and then she just wanted to kiss and make out.
I just wanted the guitarist. I didn't want the guitar lessons. But we met in Arnhem, the Netherlands, in 1984.
In September of 1984, and we were on this tour, and we went around Europe staying in all these wonderful 600-year-old hotels and working 3 hours a night and sightseeing the rest of the time, and it was just very, very, very romantic.
Yes. Yeah, we did other things besides sightseeing.
Yes, we did other things besides sightseeing. But we probably shouldn't get into that right now.
Well, we moved here in 1989, so we've been here for 27 years, and we had been living in New York City together, and then John was working on a postgraduate degree in music at Indiana University.
Yeah, it was studying to be a composer and working on my doctorate, but I realized that the only thing you can do with a doctorate in music composition is teach music theory someplace, and I didn't want to be a professor at a university.
Yeah.
And so we moved back to New York because I was working on my doctorate in Indiana, and I know everyone in Chile knows where Indiana is, but it's a state in the Midwest. We moved back to New York, and we realized that if we stayed there, we'd never see each other again because
New York, for actors, is a clearinghouse. It's where actors go to find work. So often the work that you get in New York is someplace else. So we know a lot of people whose marriages didn't last because, you know, one person would be on the road and one person would be in New York. And we wanted to spend time together. So we thought about, well, where can we go? And we had heard that Seattle, Washington had a big theater community and a lot of theater work, and it does. And
there were also a lot of mountains around here, and I grew up in Colorado, which is a very mountainous state in the West, and I thought, if we're not going to stay in New York and go for the big time, let's move to Seattle, and where I can climb mountains.
Yeah. And we had no idea, because computer games didn't even really exist at that point. So
yeah, you had arcade games.
Yeah.
But as far as games you could play on your computers, you're talking about, you know, little apples that are the size of a Kleenex box, and you know, you know they just didn't have any processor power. So we didn't have the strangest notion that we would ever be working in computer games.
Yeah, we came here for live theater. And that's what we have done, are still doing. John's going to be in a show. He starts rehearsal for a show on Tuesday called Bad Apples.
Yeah, that's true. So when we moved out here, Ellen very much encouraged me to get a voice demo, because even though she knew me as a guitarist and a composer, she thought that I could make a lot of money doing voice acting. And so when we moved out here, I did. And I got an agent. And for the first 5 years, I was doing, you know, Kentucky Fried Chicken commercials and what they call industrial films for, you know, various industries and stuff like that.
Boeing.
Yeah, and stuff. And a few, you know, a couple of television shows, a couple of little movies. But then in 1995, I got my first audition for a video game, which was, I believe, Spy Fox Breakfast Cereal. And I got that job, and then I got Betrayal at Antara, and I really started getting a lot of work in video games. And really, in 1999 or 2000, I think, I got an audition, my first audition with Valve for Half-Life 2. And at that time, Ellen was kind of going through a lull in her career, so I encouraged her to get a voice demo, which she'd never done. And so she did.
2002.
And so she auditioned for Valve. And this is, you know, the way you get you get work in video games is the same way that an actor gets work in anything. You have to get the audition, which means having an agent, and then you have to do a good enough job on the audition that they want to hire you. So Valve had already hired me to be the voice of all the citizens and Odessa Cubbage in Half-Life 2, and then Ellen auditioned for them, and they hired her to be the voice of the Overwatch. Now, at this point, Valve didn't know that we were married. They had no idea that we were married. And we did all the recordings for Half-Life 2. And then I landed the audition as the sniper in Team Fortress 2. And Ellen landed the audition as the announcer in Team Fortress 2. And they still didn't know that we were married until about halfway through Team Fortress 2, when they happened to book us on adjacent sessions in the same recording studio. And I think Ellen was there first, and she said, oh, you're going to be working with my husband next. And they went, what? And that's the first time they heard that we were married to each other. And they thought that was hilarious. And then Ellen auditioned for GLaDOS in Portal and, you know, just was launched into international fame. But they thought it was so funny that we were married to each other that they had to hire us as the bickering married couple at the end of Left 4 Dead. I'm the guy on the houseboat radio, and Ellen's in the background going, what? Oh, Dad, there's zombies all over the place. Oh, what are you doing? We need to go, and all that kind of stuff. So they thought that was pretty funny. But really, how we started working for Valve was just that. We auditioned, we got the job.
We auditioned.
Yeah. And they've made us audition for everything since. I mean, even for Dota. Even for Dota, we had to audition. So.
Oh, we love voice acting. It's a great job.
You can show up in your pajamas. You know, you don't have to memorize any lines. You don't have to wait around for the other actors. You just go into the recording studio. They give you pages full of lines, and you read them.
Yeah, and I think of it as pure acting, because all you use is your imagination and your voice, and it doesn't matter what you look like. It's everything is what you do with your thoughts and your voice.
And you have to make up the entire world around you, too. I mean, you don't have any sets, you don't have any lights, you don't have anything like that. So it's really just a lot of fun. And, of course, early on, it was very funny. Because, as you can imagine, particularly at the beginning of the industry, all the people involved in writing and creating video games were young people. Who were very much into computers and making puzzles and making mazes and animation and stuff like that. None of them had ever worked with actors before. And so when I was doing Betrayal at Antara, they just had no idea. I was there. They wouldn't even have the writers in the studio with me. I was just there with a couple of engineers, and I'd be constantly asking, well, why am I saying this? Where am I? I mean, is it loud? Is it quiet? Is it? And they wouldn't know. And they'd have to call up the writer. And so finally I got to this one line, and it was just, goodbye, son. And I said, well, that could be, you know, you could read it a million different ways depending on what's going on. And I said, well, why am I saying goodbye to my son? And so they had no idea. They had to call up the writer, and they were talking to him. Finally got back to me, and they said, okay, so this is a place where the game branches. Your son is either going to go down the street and get some bread and be right home right away, or he's going to walk through this interdimensional portal and disappear into universe, and you're never going to see him again. So could you say it in a way that would work either way? And I said, okay, goodbye, son. I said, yeah, that's great. That'll work fine. But they just had no idea. But by the time I was doing No One Lives Forever and The Suffering and games like that, the writers were always in the room, and they had come to learn how to interact with actors, what kind of information actors needed in order to do their job.
And Valve, our work for the Valve games, the Valve writers and producers give very good direction, very clear direction. They know exactly what they want. So it makes it easier for me.
And a lot more fun, because the writers of video games are all insane. They're just hilarious people. And we as actors are insane, too. And so we get along very well with each other. It's just a big party.
Yeah. I've had wonderful experiences on stage doing live work. Excellent experiences. One of my favorite roles was in a show called The Full Monty, and I played an old piano player named Jeanette, And Jerry Dixon was the director, and he's a great stage director.
Here comes the Oscar acceptance speech. Yes. Just be aware.
So that experience was wonderful. But then the creative process for Portal and Portal 2 was so much fun. You know, when I first started the work on Portal, I didn't know where it was going. I just thought that I was the vocal prompt for the player to help the player through the game. And at one point, I said, I don't understand this. Am I going to lie to the player?
And it went downhill from there.
Yes. And Eric Wolpaw said, yeah, you're lying. You're lying to the player. Oh, okay. So,
but it's really two profoundly different crafts. I often compare stage work to any kind of recorded work, either film or voice acting. Is the difference between playing a concert? I mean, doing a play in front of a live audience is like doing a concert. Making a movie or doing voice work is like making a record, making a recording. So, in a concert or in a play, it's all real time. You're making the best choices you can as the time goes by, because you don't have any chance to edit, you don't have any chance to go back and make it better. And so that's very exciting, and the response from the audience is very immediate. But in voice acting and in movies and stuff like that, you have the chance to get it just right. And I mean, particularly our work with Valve has been just incredible and so much fun and so creative. But we're working on a new video game now called The Church in the Darkness with Richard Rouse, whom I did The Suffering 1 and 2 with back in the 90s. And that's been just a great ride,
yes,
too.
Yes, yes. We play two very interesting characters, a man and wife, you know, husband and wife.
But it's a top-down, with what they call a top-down infiltration game. But we're the married leaders of a cult that you have to go down and get your nephew out of. And it's just been a lot of fun. But anyway, to say which one do we prefer, it's like, you know, do I prefer sunny days on the beach or climbing mountains? I mean, I wouldn't want to give up either one. They're both great.
Well, as John and I like to say, you know, we're both in our 60s. So for young people to be interested in what we're doing or what we're about is so unusual, and we're very grateful to, you know, our work in games and the game industry, and so many young game fans have become friends of ours.
We feel like the grandma and grandpa of the game community.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of our fans think of us that way too. But it's also made us both very optimistic, because the young people we've met through gaming have all been so creative and so intelligent and so full of fun and life and optimism.
Yes, and kind.
Yeah.
And kind and thoughtful.
And wanting to solve problems, wanting to make the world a better place. And the other thing that makes me feel very optimistic is that the gaming community is a worldwide community. It doesn't really know. You guys are up here in Seattle from Chile. There are people at Dota International from all over the world. And even in all of the other games that we've done, we've met fans from all over the planet.
Gaming brings the world closer together.
Ellen lives life in mottos and slogans.
Oh my gosh, he's a genius. He is a genius. And I did work with him, but I was in a studio here in Seattle, and he was in a studio down in Los Angeles, but I was connected to him through my headphones. So for Gypsy Danger, he was directing me through my ears. And it was wonderful. I didn't understand what the Jaegers were, the Jaegers. And, you know, he had to explain to me exactly what was happening in the movie, and that I was voicing a 25-story robot. And that was the voice that I was creating. And, of course, initially, Del Toro asked Gabe Newell at Valve if he could use the voice of GLaDOS. And thank you, Gabe Newell. Gabe Newell said yes, but of course that's Ellen McLean. So if you want to use the voice of GLaDOS, you must hire Ellen McLean to do it. And ultimately, I gave the same reads for Del Toro as I would as GLaDOS, the computer. But ultimately, my voice was processed in a slightly different way. And I think that Gypsy Danger sounds more human than GLaDOS does. But it was a great honor, and I'd work for him anytime.
But I have to say that she was up here in Seattle because she didn't have time to go down to L.A. because Guillermo wanted her to go down to L.A. because his daughter and he were both big fans of GLaDOS. So he wanted his daughter to meet Ellen, but she only met him over the... His daughter met you over the microphone,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. She was in the studio with her father, and we got to talk. We got to talk a little bit.
Well, we got to go down to Hollywood for the cast and crew premiere, and we got to actually meet Guillermo in person. Mm-hmm. And he's just as nice as everyone says he is. He's just a great big fanboy. He's wonderful.
I'm an introvert. Oddly enough, I'm an actor, but I'm an introvert. And I think that I'm also, as John likes to say, I am passive aggressive. And I think that, you know, I am GLaDOS in, you know, my worst moments. You know, GLaDOS doesn't really want to kill anyone. She just wants to test. And that's all she thinks about. And I think at the end of Portal 2, I think she really has grown very fond of Chell. No matter what she says about Chell, I think she's grown very fond of Chell and is actually...
This is non-canonical.
This is non-canonical, you're right. This is apocryphal.
The attitudes and opinions of these people are not the attitudes and opinions of Valve Corporation.
That's right. But I think GLaDOS is kind of sad to say goodbye to Chell. And then, of course, you know, the wonderful turret opera that Mike Moraski composed, where all the little turrets sing goodbye to Chell, is very poignant. So, yes, GLaDOS is me, and I am GLaDOS. Oh, GLaDOS.
I think for Valve, the most fun I have is with Sniper, although I have to say that both Storm Spirit and Pudge in Dota are a lot of fun, too. I have the most fun at Valve with the characters that have the best senses of humor or are the darkest. And... I mean, you know, Doom and Earthshaker, I mean, those guys are fun, but they're both mostly just big, mean badasses. Storm Spirit is so completely full of himself and conceited, and Pudge is just so focused. He's just a hungry guy who likes to eat people, you know. So working class guys who like to eat people, and professional snipers, and, you know, completely egotistical actors, they're my favorites.
Yeah. Oh, well, GLaDOS has hysterical lines. And actually, when in Portal 2, when Eric Wolpaw and Jay Pinkerton told me that I was going to be a potato battery, that's when I totally lost it. I totally lost it because I thought, that is so brilliant. Because a potato battery, you know, you make them in science class in grade school, and they're so weak. And I thought that was the funniest.
I mean, for the Sniper, a lot of his dominating lines are great. I mean, I love things, you know, the bullet's coming out of the slim end, mate, you know, and that was so easy, I think I'm getting worse. I like those kind of things. But really, I think it was the Meet the Sniper video that was the most hilarious for me when I got to say things like, you know, feelings. You know, there's a lot of feelings. Blokes what bludgeon their wives to death with a golf trophy. Professionals have standards. Be polite. Be efficient. Have a plan to kill everyone you meet. And particularly when he was talking to his dad on the phone. You know, he said, Dad, I'm not a crazed gunman, Dad. I'm an assassin. Well, a difference being one is a job and the other's mental sickness, you know, and stuff like that. The fact that the sniper's parents didn't approve of what he did was just hilarious to me. So,
well, broodmother was the hardest.
My little spider things. If you can listen to this, you can hear how hard this is on my voice. So, broodmother, it's very difficult.
For me, in an odd way, the reason that Storm Spirit sounds the way he does, he talks up here like this. Well, when I went in to do that session, I did, I think, Earthshaker and Doom and, I think, Darkseer. We're all very down, you know, Earthshaker and Doom and all this kind of stuff. But I had just had a really bad cold, and I didn't have any middle voice. I mean, I could talk way down here, or I could talk up here, but I couldn't talk in the middle. My voice is just gone. So that's why Storm Spirit talks the way he does.
Well, it's fun. I never know what Jay Pinkerton is going to come up with. So, but the administrator or the announcer, people call her, you know, more than one name, but she never changes. She is so angry and so disappointed. I call her the skinny bitch, the skinny old bitch. And she's so funny. So I never, you know, it's always fun finding out what the writers, what Jay and the other writers have come up with. So it's great fun.
Yeah, I think for the sniper, I mean, their Valve is working on getting Team Fortress 2 is a much more major player in the esports world, and so they're working on the competitive mode. And for a long time, Sniper wasn't in the competitive mode, so they've had me in to do a lot of lines for that, which is great because since the Sniper wasn't in the competitive mode before, he can say things like, "Well, now you got a Sniper, we got a chance," and stuff like that. So it's a lot of fun. Jay comes up with some great lines, and it's just always a gas going out there and working for them. I have always liked video games. I've been a fan of animation since I was little. And when I first started playing Myst and then Riven, to actually have a world that was created that didn't really exist anywhere but was just drawn by people so that I could walk around in it was an amazing thing to me. So I love Half-Life 2. I've played it probably 50 times. Team Fortress 2 just moves too fast for me. I played it a little bit, but every time I get on there, it's like, oh my God. I'm still, you know, I'm addicted to Civ 5. And I think that that video games are really going to come into their own as a form of literature, as a form of teaching, and while keeping their entertainment value and just being fun. I think that people enjoy playing them and can learn all kinds of cool life lessons from the moral ambiguities that you get in video games. Did you already answer the question?
Well, your answer was so good. Why should I?
Oh, okay. Right. No. That's right. I do all the work. She just kind of sits around and is wonderful. I mean, right now, Ellen and I are both working on the video game The Church in the Darkness with Richard Rouse, and that hopefully is going to be released in early 2017. I'm also working on a screenplay, a series about a young white woman who wants to be a jazz singer and a young black man who wants to be a classical pianist, and it takes place at the dawn of World War II. And so that's a project I'm working on. I'm also working on three other novels that I really need to decide which one I want to work on and do it. But also, I have an ongoing relationship with Jim French Productions, Imagination Theater. We have just been the first, just became the first production company in the Western Hemisphere to dramatize all of Arthur Conan Doyle's original Sherlock Holmes stories, and I play Sherlock Holmes in all of those. And that project continues. We also do new Sherlock Holmes stories. Right now, as part of our development for The Church in the Darkness, I've been writing the songs that will go over the closing credits. This is an idea that Richard got from Portal, actually. He thought that if we were going to be in the game, that the fans would want to hear us sing a song over the credits. So at this point, I've written 3.5 songs I still have to finish up the lyric of the fourth song. But I plan to write more music, and I plan to keep writing. And we both still audition for theater all the time. Like I said, I go into rehearsal for Bad Apples, which is, if you can believe this, a new musical about the torture that went on at Abu Ghraib prison in Baghdad in the Iraq War. Very powerful piece. And I have a couple of other offers out there, or a couple of other job possibilities out there. So I'm sure that Ellen and I will continue to act in theater here and in video games whenever we can. And I will keep writing and publishing whenever I can. So this is funny because, you know, Valve hires me to invite and Ellen too to be the voices of various characters in Dota 2. Valve also hires me to be the voice of the International. So you guys are going to be hearing me announce the teams and stuff all week this week. But a completely different guy hires me to be in this choir that occasionally does. And for the last year, for the first time, we did the closing music in the closing ceremonies at the International, and we're going to be doing that again this year. So that it's a lot of fun for me to actually get here and see the fans and actually see Gabe Newell in the same room, because we've never met him, actually.
We've never met him. But I have to brag on John. John is a wonderful singer. And people who don't know singing very well, John has a very strong low C, which is a very low note. And it's very unusual. So John does a lot of singing because he has a good voice and a low voice. And when I first met him, one of the first things I said to him, I said, "Oh my gosh, you have a great voice. You need to do voice acting." And I was right.
And many, many years later, I said, "Stop being so lonely. Stop being so lazy. Get yourself a voice demo and get out there and start earning us some money." And I was right.
My favorite music is Mozart's opera Le Nozze di Figaro, The Marriage of Figaro. That's my favorite music. My favorite movie is probably Waiting for Guffman, and it's a Christopher Guest movie, and it's about a small town and a group of community theater actors, and that's my favorite movie. And I would say, oh, I have so many favorite books. But I would have to say one of my favorite books is called The Confederacy of Dunces by John Kennedy Toole. And it was published posthumously in like 1962. And it won the Pulitzer Prize here in the United States, The Confederacy of Dunces. And it's set in New Orleans. And it is a very, very funny book.
Okay, so book, movie, and music. Okay, really, really tough. Because I read a lot of books, I go to a lot of movies, and I listen to a lot of music. So this is going to kind of be arbitrary, and I don't know if I can narrow it down to one. I think for books, my three favorite books are probably Huckleberry Finn by Mark Twain, The Best and the Brightest by David Halberstam, and A Fine Balance by Rohinden Mistry. Huckleberry Finn is this amazingly accurate and dark and yet funny and poignant portrait of systemic racism in the United States in the 19th century. The Best and the Brightest is a brilliant journalistic telling of how the United States got into the Vietnam War and couldn't get out. And then A Fine Balance is a wonderful novel about life in India and the caste system there. Let's see. Favorite movie. Well, I just have so many. I mean, I could list off a million. She just said Howl's Moving Castle, which is certainly one of my favorite movies. 2001 A Space Odyssey is one of my favorite movies. The Lord of the Rings movies are one of my favorite movies. But then, I mean, there are all these great movies. I mean, we've just seen three of my favorite movies recently this year. We just saw Microbe and Gasoil, which is a French movie about two little kids. We just saw, what was the
Hunt for the
Hunt for the Wilder People, which I thought was wonderful. But I mean, I just know so many great movies, and really when you get into music, that's even vaster. I mean, I would say that all time, probably Stravinsky's ballet, Petrushka. Well, yeah, I mean, all the three great Stravinsky ballets, the music of Jimi Hendrix, the music of Keith Jarrett, the music of Duke Ellington, the music of Brahms, the music of Robert Johnson, and Indian classical music and Balinese classical music. That's about as narrowed down as I can get.
Well, this weekend, we just took the most beautiful drive through the mountains. We left Seattle on Thursday, and we took Route 20 over through the North Cascades National Park. And then we drove along the Columbia River down to a little town called Waterville. And we stayed at one of our favorite hotels, the Waterville Hotel, which was built in 1907. And then we drove back through the mountains on Route 2 back to Seattle to meet all of you.
Well, but I have to say, in full disclosure, we love going to concerts. We love going to symphony concerts. We love going to jazz concerts. I went to a great kind of Southern funk concert with my daughter back in Indiana a couple months ago, which was fabulous. We love going to the opera.
We're going to see Le Comte d'Ory, which is opening, opened last night, actually. It's at Seattle Opera.
People in Chile really need to know that, so that's good that you brought that up.
Well, it's by Rossini.
That's true, yes, right. And then I also like to urban hike. I used to like to climb mountains, but I blew out my knees in the Canadian Rockies, so I can't do that anymore. And we like watching comedy and dramas on you know, Netflix and stuff like that. And I like to play video games. So that's kind of us.
We do appreciate this opportunity to have an interview with you. So we brought you some gifts from Chile.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
Thank you. I want to show this. This is from
Alex. Oh,
oh. Oh, and that looks like
it's
handmade.
Oh,
yay!
Oh, this is beautiful. This is beautiful. You know, I don't have one. I have never gotten a companion cube. So this is my own companion cube. It's beautiful. Thank you.
We have olive oil.
Oh, wonderful.
Oh, yes.
We love olive oil. We cook with it a lot. Oh, this looks wonderful. This is extra virgen. It really hasn't ever had sex.
Right. So that's great.
Also, we brought you a Chilean wine.
Oh, Chilean wine. Oh, wonderful. Toro de piedra.
Bull of rock. Yes, bull of rock.
Wonderful. Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Chili powder.
Oh. Chili powder from Chile.
Yes. Okay.
I love hot food.
Great.
Right.
Well, I make what I call chili, and so I will have real Chilean chili
right.
to put in my chili.
Well, I'm gonna dust this on like the chicken that I bake and stuff like that. You know, this is wonderful.
This is
Thank
great.
You so much.
Thank you.
Well, can we say, oh, buenos dias, Chile? ¿Qué tal?
Encantada de conocerlos. ¿Sí? Guillermo and Alejandro and Caro and Emma. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. And have a great Dota 2! Yay, the International! Is that it? Are we good?
Great.